What's up, geeks and gamers? It's Odin, and today we're going to be talking about the box office breakdown. Yes, indeed, I am back home. Thank you all so much for the support over on the Geeks and Gamers channel while we were at Star Wars Celebration. Jeremy is still over there as we speak with Anna and also Jesse Milestone. So it is still hopping over there. They've just covered, as of making of this video, they just covered the Mandalorian panel. They're still live streaming last time I checked. So this is indeed very exciting news because the Mandalorian looks fantastic. Go check out my channel. Just did a video on it just a few minutes ago about how this is the Star Wars that we actually need. But getting to the actual box office itself, oh boy, Hellboy is the boy we talk about today, and Hellboy is looking like it's gonna bomb. Even though it only cost about $50 million to make, this is an anemic opening. The fact that this film came in at number 3 on its opening weekend and lost out to a movie called Little, which opened in like 600 or so less screens, is not very good. And it was made for about half as much. So Little, for some reason, and we'll get into what that is because I myself have only heard about it a little bit. But obviously Hellboy not doing very well, made $12 million. Next weekend is Easter, not likely going to be a very big, very good weekend for that movie. And then of course, in just a couple weeks, we have Endgame. So it looks like Hellboy is going to fizzle out very, very quickly. And unless it does bonkers overseas, which I'll have to take a look at the numbers a little bit deeper, doesn't seem like this is going to be a film that is going to make a whole lot of money. Might potentially break even, going to cost about $75 million total when you add in marketing. 60% or so of $100 million would put it just, So it needs to make a lot. It needs to make well over $100 million in order to break even, which is not very good. Another film that came out called Missing Link. This is actually a Leica product. I don't know if anyone's ever seen Leica's products before, but they make some pretty good movies. I personally really liked movies like Paranorman. I think one of my favorites was Coraline. I will say, though, I think the best thing that they've done so far was Kubo and the Two Strings, which just looked fantastic. The story was great, too. And Missing Link didn't look very interesting to me. It looked more of like a Wallace and Gromit type film, and I'm not really into those types of films in general, but this one's getting pretty good reviews so far, and, you know, $5.8 million for this type of film, not the worst thing in the world. Obviously, I think they're going to want to hope to get a little bit more because it does still cost some money to make these type of, you know, stop motion animation films. But overall, that is the overall breakdown of the weekend, with Shazam indeed coming in at number one with another $25.1 million, with about a 53% drop in the North American market, which is actually not bad. It's actually a pretty decent drop. You know, you normally you see films in that range. If it's a very, very, you know, a steep drop off is any time you see a movie around in the 60s or so, upper 50s, 53% is a modest drop. And so this is a film that, again, total gross so far, when you look at this, the domestic market has made just about $94 million. And so with the overseas market, which isn't going bonkers for it, it still would be enough to be able to, you know, push this film over the, you know, over the finish line. So as we see right now, this film is at $221.2 billion. So it's not doing nearly as well as some other films have made. And it is indeed going to continue to slow down as more films come out, and of course the closer that we get to Endgame. As you can see up here, foreign market 126.3, that is not a very good showing from the foreign market, unfortunately. It looks like based on this pacing that it could probably end up a little bit north of $200 million when you look to that market, and then probably north of domestically $100 million, which means you're looking at around $300 to $350 million film. I would say that the best case scenario, if somehow it has crazy legs and is able to have a crazy, you know, Easter weekend, could see it get closer to $400 million, but it seems like $400 would definitely be the top for this film. But it doesn't really need to make that much. As you can see, it was made for $100 million just for a frame, you know, frame of reference. Alita: Battle Angel was made for about $155 million and needed to make around $430 million to break even. When you add in marketing costs, this film overall was made, and that's not even counting the marketing, this film was made for $100 million, meaning that this film doesn't have to make nearly as much. Again, if it gets over $350 million, I would say you could probably be able to argue, because some people say that because of tax breaks and tax credits, the actual production budget itself works out closer to $80 to $90 million. But obviously, we'll know more about the financials as we see, you know, start to see these things come out. However, as we all know, this is week two, and whenever you have a week two film, you're usually able to tell, you know, have a pretty good prediction as to how much it's going to make overall. Usually films make around 60% of their entire box office take when you have the first 2 weeks of a movie. This film has made $221 million, meaning that at best it's going to make $440 million, and at worst it's going to probably crap out around, again, that $350 to $400 million range. So it seems that this definitely has a, you know, an end goal in sight. The question is, how much money can it continue to make? Can it possibly be number one after another weekend? Are there going to be other films that are going to come out that are going to, you know, be able to actually compete against it? It's going to be a very big question nonetheless. But Shazam, doing okay. Okay, go out and see it. Guys, it's a solid film. It might be my favorite DC film yet so far. I obviously think there's certain parts of other films that I really enjoy too, but as far as an overall film, I really enjoyed it. It was very solid. Great acting, great writing, direction, cinematography looks great, and also, of course, CGI, which was always a big concern of mine, ended up looking pretty damn good. All right, this movie Little, which I have heard nothing about, by Tina Gordon, Chisholm. It's a Regina Hall film, and so it's, you know, making money domestically, and it's only going to make money domestically, so it only costs about $20 million. This film is going to make its money back just because, obviously, it was released for, it had a certain audience in mind for the film, and so therefore that audience is going to show up for it. How much they show up for it is a definitely a big question mark, because audiences in general go to see many different things. Not one audience or one group is ever going to just see one type of film. However, there's definitely going to be a very strong portion of the United States population that is going to be supporting this film no matter what, and so we're going to see, again, probably make its money back, maybe. But again, coming in at number two, coming in over this film right here, Hellboy, is just awful. We don't even have any foreign totals yet, which tells me this film is in a great deal of trouble. Let's see, is there any information yet? There is no information yet. One territory being tracked for this weekend. Oh boy. So as we can see here, it's still very early. Obviously, if it gets released and we start getting some foreign numbers and those numbers are turning out to be gigantic, obviously it could easily make money back because it only costs about $50 million to make. And that means that the total cost for the film was around $75 million. That's not a whole lot of money when you have a big name product like this, when you have a big budget, you know, what's normally a big budget film like this being made for so little. But that might also be the reason why it's not doing as well. On top of the fact, no one was really asking for a Hellboy reboot. There were many people saying, oh, we want Guillermo del Toro to make, you know, to make number three, to make Hellboy 3 with the same cast. But they decided to recast with David Harbour now as Hellboy. They decided to change directors. They decided to change directions. And as you can see, it has cost them. So it's going to be interesting to see if this film actually flops or not. It's really hard to tell this early on in general, but especially when you don't even have a foreign total. So because the production budget was so low, even though the domestic total is very low, still need to wait to see what that foreign market's going to do. And of course, it wouldn't be a nay, it wouldn't be a weekend without talking about Captain Marvel, which, as you can see, has slowed down tremendously. So this is a film that got off to crazy amounts. Again, in 3 weeks, it made over $950 million, has not really made a whole lot since then. And I think that does definitely speak to the fact that this was very, you know, front-loaded in the end. You know, it was very heavily front-loaded with its release. And so obviously it made a crap ton of money very quick. It was available in almost every theater imaginable, to the point where you had empty theaters, half-empty theaters, and I think that's the reason why, is because it was just in so many theaters that even though it made money, it was making money because the average ticket prices were higher than what normal films would be, and also it was just available to most people in general. So again, 1.064. Again, so that means that, you know, my early projections of 1.3 to 1.5, which are normally accurate, means that this film made almost way too much in the first 2 to 3 weeks, so it's obviously not going to have too much legs after, because again, it's just every single day, it's just losing more and more revenue. But it's still a billion-dollar film. It's still profitable. It's going to top out probably around 1.1, max 1.2. Don't see it getting close to 1.2. But again, obviously, you never know. But still, a little over $1 billion. This is a film that, remember, it's great because it made money, because that's the logic that no one has ever used in history. Missing Link, as I said before, $5.8 million. Production budget is unknown. Obviously, this is because it's, you know, stop motion is going to have a lower production budget than the CGI-heavy films. But it's still going to be a decent amount because it does cost a lot of money and takes a lot of time to make these films. So obviously, this is going to be directed and written by Chris Butler, and this is from Leica Studios. As I said before, Leica does some really good work with stop motion, and the fact that they're still making those types of films is really cool. This film is one I didn't really have a whole lot of interest in. Zach Galifianakis, Hugh Jackman are some of the voices in here. It's basically about a primate that's able to speak, and so that's the reason why I was kind of like, ah, I don't really know. It is Leica, though, only an hour and 35 minutes. Seems like it'd be a good family choice. So if I go to see it, I will let you guys know on the main channel, on my channel, whether or not it is worth seeing. And then I know there's a strong Alita contingency out there. Alita is at $403.5 million, so still making a little bit of cash. Looking like it's going to stop right under $405 million. Still no Blu-ray 4K DVD release date yet. And as I said before, the reason why likely is because, remember, this is the last Fox movie. This is the last official mainstream, wide release Fox property before the Disney acquisition. Meaning that this is a film that's going to take a while to get into this post-production, you know, this post-post-production, you know, making of the 4Ks and the various discs, because there's a lot of behind-the-scenes chaos with people being fired, moved around. So I'm guaranteeing you this one's being put on the back burner for now. They're not going to rush this out. Obviously, I wish they did because I would love to buy it. But at the same time, too, hopefully it means they're going to wait to get the right people on the job, wait until everything's settled down so they can actually handle it properly and give us a proper transfer and a proper 4K Blu-ray DVD release. So that's just an update on that. And also, guys, today has been great. This weekend has been great. Thank you all so much for all of the support, the super chats, the donations, the likes, everything, the sharing of the videos. It's been fantastic. We are truly appreciative of everything that y'all have been doing for us on the Geeks and Gamers channel, because we know, obviously, that we are trying to do everything that we can for you, but we can't do anything without you guys. So once again, thank you so much for your support. Have a wonderful day. If you like this video, smash the like button, give us a subscribe. Basically live on the Geeks and Gamers channel, because we're going to be doing live streams, we're going to be doing video coverage all freaking weekend. Jeremy's going to be here at least all the way till the Clone Wars panel, which is going to be later today, so he's going to be covering the Clone Wars panel later today, and I think he might stay through Monday. Obviously, there's still a lot of things that are questioning, up in the air, but guys, stay close to the channel, because there's going to be a lot of good stuff. Thank you guys for watching. Check over my channel, Oda's Movie Vlog, because I'd appreciate that, and as always, God bless.